Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is The Mummy Returns, made in 2001 for the Game Boy Color by Game Brains. The Mummy Returns is a 2001 sequel to the surprise smash hit movie The Mummy, made 2 years prior by Universal Pictures. This film was also a huge hit, making well over $200 million in the US box office, despite mixed reviews from the fans and critics alike. The success of this movie series spawned a cartoon series as well as various video games based on this movie. The movie stars a lot of the same people from the first movie, as well as some new, well-known stars to the series. Those include Brandon Fraser as the star explorer and hero, Rick O'Connell. Rachel Weisz in the role of the female explorer and wife of Rick, namely Evelyn O'Connell. Arnold Vosloo as the mummy and evil Egyptian high priest troublemaker Imhotep. And former wrestler turned actor Dwayne The Rock Johnson portrays the dangerous and formidable commander of Anubis' army, the Scorpion King. Following the events of the first Mummy movie, Rick O'Connell and his wife Evelyn find the bracelet of the Scorpion King buried within an ancient tomb. Followers of Imhotep want to get hold of said bracelet so they can control the armies of Anubis, which are controlled by the Scorpion King. The bracelet is brought back to England by the O'Connells, and Rick and Evelyn's son Alex puts the bracelet on, activating its power, and is now unable to remove it until he reaches the pyramid that the bracelet has shown him to go to. Meanwhile, the followers of Imhotep have revived their high priest lord once again, and he too wants the bracelet to control the armies of Anubis for his own. Alex, who is still wearing the bracelet, is kidnapped by Imhotep's servants and is forced to assist them on the way to finding the Scorpion King. Rick, his wife, brother-in-law John, and a warrior named Ardeth all jump into the battle to stop the mummy once again, as well as get back their kidnapped son. They follow Imhotep all over Egypt via air balloon until they finally arrive at the destination. The son is reunited with the family after various battles, and Ardeth gathers his own warriors to take on the armies of Anubis, which were awakened as the Scorpion King is revived by the bracelet. Imhotep and Rick battle it out with the balance of the world in their very hands. Rick is able to defeat Imhotep and the Scorpion King with a little luck and help from his friends, and the army of the dead is sent back to where they came from, all in the nick of time, and the world is saved for another day from the forces of evil. So, how does the Game Boy Color version of this movie hold up? Let's find out. One good thing gone for this game is that it does follow the path of the movie well enough. It will start you out right away in a familiar situation. Rick must avoid the flooding chambers of the ancient building that he has to get out of while he races through obstacles and enemies in front of him. So, the game does at least try to follow the movie well, and that is something going for it. But that, unfortunately, is the only thing it has going for it. Even for a Game Boy Color game, this game has a lot of problems that really make this unenjoyable to play. Each stage will start you out with a stage objective text that you push a button to decode from ancient Egyptian to English. It's an interesting idea to have the person playing the game feel like they are part of the adventure, but it really comes off as a waste of time, as it really doesn't add anything to the game, but make for a minor annoyance to have to hold a button to read what part of the game you are at next. And the passwords work in the same exact way too. They were put around weird-looking shapes and circles, and you had to push a button to decode it. This all could have been done very much simply and user-friendly than it turned out to be. They are nice little eye candies, but they really made the game more frustrating to enjoy than adding anything to the adventure. Also, at the start of each stage, you will have the option of which of the major characters to use. Mostly that consisted of Rick, Ardeth, and Evelyn. Each character will sometimes give a different way to get through each of the oncoming stages. This, in theory, will add some replayability to what turns out to be a very short game otherwise, but in execution, it doesn't work as well as probably hoped by the designers. Due to this strange selection method, you can have three different options of how you want to get through a given stage. So you can sword battle, target practice shoot, or action scroll your way through some of the stages. If it's not one of these stages, it will be an avoid a swarm of something coming at you while you run and avoid obstacles and enemies in your way type of stage. It's not that these are all bad ideas, but it's that the execution of such stages and the way they go about it that makes this game almost unplayable at points. The sword stages will be you using one of the characters in one-on-one battles with various enemies that relate to the part of the movie you are up to. But what it amounts to is you moving back and forth as you mash the attack button until he is defeated and leaves a heart, giving you some of your health back, and repeating again 3 more times, and then the stage will end. There was nothing exciting or challenging at any time when you would be stuck in one of these sword battle stages. Target shooting was much harder than the sword battles. You would have to use a tiny target and hit all the enemies on the screen, all the while avoiding being hit by oncoming projectiles. More often than not, you would be hit before you were able to shoot and wind up ducking a lot to avoid things. There's a time limit too, making this even harder. These stages are beatable, but why anyone would want to when the sword option takes only a few moments to complete is the real question. The last type of stage would be where you get to use a pistol and have to venture through a scrolling stage, shooting at enemies and creatures, and making it to the end without losing all your energy. Otherwise, you start back at the beginning to do it all over again. This too can be annoying, as the stages can be long and the obstacles annoying to avoid. These stages are beatable with some time and practice, but the game just isn't fun enough to devote time to doing the longer aspects of this game. The only different moment in the game comes when they throw a flying chase stage that relived the waterfall chasing the balloon moment of the film. It's the same avoid things flying at you as you venture through narrow twists and turns till you reach the destination. I would like to say this was a welcome breath of fresh air in the game, but it was really the same thing as before, just done slightly different. The play control issues found in this game are unexcusable, especially when you had to do one of the run and avoid the swarm stages. Your character seemed to jump as if it was one-legged, and the jumps would often not activate when you wanted them to, leading to your easy death and this very familiar screen of game over. At least they let you start halfway through a stage if you made it that far, but play control was just awful in every aspect of this game. If the play control was even a tad better, this game may have been a bit more fun than it was. But adding how bad the play control does turn out to be, it makes this game a real frustrating adventure. If they are going to make the stages full of pits to jump over quickly, at least make it where you can jump easy enough to manage it. Most of the times, you had to be lucky to get your jump to work, and only to find out that you had a whole new group of pits to avoid that you would have to get lucky with also. It was just very frustrating to get the controls to work properly at many aspects in this game. The graphics aren't really that great either, even for a Game Boy Color game. The only graphical pieces found in this game are the game over still screens that take a moment right out of the movie, but for some reason they look like they were drawn by a kid rather than a professional graphic artist working on the game. And after seeing them a dozen times or so from the poor play control, you will grow tired of them very fast. The backgrounds of the games are very lackluster and simplistic. The moments from the movie were all there, but it was more they were explained via the text at the beginning of the stage over what we were venturing through. Even the characters themselves, as you were controlling them, looked nothing like who they were supposed to be. You were a one-eyed silhouette with two colors found fighting some faceless thug. If you were playing this without watching the movie, you would have no idea who's human and who's a creature, as everyone seemed to look like weird blobs with no facial features. Some other graphical problems were with the chase stages. They all seemed to be built exactly the same way graphically. A huge colored wall was moving in towards you. Keep moving to avoid it. It was just nothing graphically impressive found anywhere in this game, and that's too bad, as the film itself did have some very nice special effects. In a way, you're glad this game is short and to the point. It gets frustrating and old fast. The only boss battle found within is with the Scorpion King himself, and that becomes a very bad version of the target practice option that you could do on other stages. You just shoot at his head every now and then with your crosshairs, duck down to avoid two random circles he fires at you, and repeat the process. Thrilling chase and situation in the movie is reduced to something simplistic and unrelated. I don't remember Rick firing a gun at the Scorpion King at any time. They could have at least had the spear show up after you defeat him to add some continuity to the situation. It's fitting that this game ends in another horrible chase. Getting through this last stage of the game will probably take longer than you wish, due to how many hard jumps you will have to make while avoiding obstacles along the way. Surprisingly, choosing Rick or Evelyn will give you different running stages to do. You can get why they would have different stages to go through when they both escape together in the movie. When you finally do manage this long and frustrating adventure at the end of the game, it ends with a not surprising simplistic congratulations still screen of you flying off into the sunset. This is one game I don't think I'm going out on a limb by saying you won't be returning too often to relive. That's supposed to be it, I couldn't tell, so I say no to that. This theme sounds nothing like anything from the movie. The music sorta had the flavor of the great Alvin Silvestri soundtrack found in the film, but that is where the comparisons end. The music has high pings and offbeat sounds that will make you turn the volume down rather than enjoy listening to it. Most of the time it's repetitive beats and didn't sound anything like heard in the film. The game tries to be way too much, but one thing is for sure, it's not fun at any point. If it's not the poor play control and bad graphics, it's the highly pitched music that is booming out of the Game Boy Color that will annoy you. Even though they'll give you options for what you would like to do on some stages, you still won't be running back to play this often. I'm surprised Universal went to a small company to have this game made when the first Mummy Game Boy Color adaptation by Konami was so much better. Avoid this game at all costs, and it's going to get a... That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.